गुड मॉर्निंग चिल्ड्रेन।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
वी स्टार्टेड विद द चैप्टर सेल द यूनिट ऑफ लाइफ एंड आई जस्ट गेव यू एन इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ द चैप्टर एंड यू हैड बीन लर्निंग अबाउट सेल फ्रॉम क्लास सेल सॉरी फ्रॉम क्लास 8 9th also you had learned about cell. Now more details, more about the different organelles present in a cell we are going to learn. So let us begin. Cell, the unit of life. You know that cell is a structural and functional unit of life. All living organisms are made up of cells. A cell is the fundamental, structural, and functional unit of all living organisms. All living organisms are made up of cells, and a cell is a structural, functional, and fundamental unit of life. And you know that cells were first discovered by Robert Hooke in 1665. He observed a slice of cork, and cork is a dead tissue, and he observed dead cells for the first time. Later, Anton von Leeuwenhoek, he observed a sample of pond water, or he examined or he observed a sample of pond water, and he could see living cells in pond water. So the credit for observing living cells for the first time goes to Anton von Leeuwenhoek. These scientists, when they observe the cells, living cells and dead cells through the microscope, it was not as sophisticated or as advanced like present day microscopes, but with the advancement or with the invention of compound and electron microscopes that revealed the structural details of the cell. So the structural details, so earlier they were just able to examine these living cells as well as the dead cells, but the details, the structural details, they were not able to observe because it was not a very good microscope, very sophisticated one was not available at that time. They used some improvised microscope just to magnify these tissues and to observe the cells, or the sample of pond water could be magnified just to examine those living cells in the sample. But later, with the invention of compound microscope and electron microscopes, they were able to learn, the scientists were able to learn the structural details of the cell. Schleiden and Schwann, Matthias Schleiden and Theodor Schwann, these two German scientists, they put forward the cell theory. And that was in 1838. Matthias Schleiden observed that plants are made up of cells. Later, in 1839, Theodor Schwann reported that the cells are having a boundary, an outer layer, which is known as plasma membrane now. And he also found that in plant cells, there is an additional layer known as cell wall. And he proposed a hypothesis that animals and plants are made up of cells and products of cells. Actually, three scientists, they contributed to the formation of cell theory. The third scientist is Rudolf Virchow. So Matthias Schleiden, Theodor Schwann, and even Rudolf Virchow contributed to the formation of cell theory. So Matthias Schleiden, in 1838, he found out that plants are made up of cells, and Theodor Schwann found out, or he observed that all cells are covered by a plasma membrane or an outer boundary, an outer layer, and in plant cells there is an additional layer which is known as cell wall. So based on that, he proposed a hypothesis that plants and animals, or all living things, are made up of cells and products of cells. And Rudolf Virchow in 1855, many years later, he explained that the existing cells divide and form new cells, or else you can say cells arise from pre-existing cells. So already existing cells will undergo division and they will form new cells. Or you can say it is omnis cellula e cellula, which means cells arise from pre-existing cells. And he just modified the cell theory. So cell theory was proposed by Matthias Schleiden and Theodor Schwann, but later in 1855, when he found out that cells, new cells are formed from pre-existing cells, he just modified the cell theory. And cell theory states that all living organisms are made up of cells and products of cells, and all cells arise from pre-existing cells. So cell theory was formed by, or this was with the help of the contributions of the cell theory, was formed by three scientists: Rudolf Virchow, Matthias Schleiden and Theodor Schwann. So once again we will see the contributions of these three scientists. Matthias Schleiden, he observed that plants are made up of cells. And Theodor Schwann, 1 year later, he reported that, or he could observe an outer boundary for all the cells, which is known as plasma membrane now. And he also found out that in plant cells, there is an additional layer, that is cell wall. And based on the observations, he proposed a hypothesis that animals and plants are composed of cells and products of cells. And many years later, or a few years later, in 1855, this was modified. Cell theory was modified by Rudolf Virchow. He observed, or he understood, that new cells can be formed only by the division of existing cells, or else you can say new cells arise from pre-existing cells. So the cell theory is modified as all plants and animals are composed of cells and products of cells, and cells arise from pre-existing cells. Okay, can I proceed?
Ma'am, wait.
Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Yes. All cells contain cytoplasm. So some important constituents of cell found in all living cells. In all living cells, you can find some basic components. So one is cytoplasm. Cytoplasm is a semi-fluid matrix, and this is present between the nucleus and the cell membrane, where the different cellular activities and chemical reactions are taking place. This will keep the cell in living state, because all different reactions. So this is a site for different reactions taking place, and the different cell organelles are also scattered in the cytoplasm. Once again, cytoplasm is a semi-fluid matrix, and the different cell organelles are present in the cytoplasm, and the different metabolic reactions or different cellular activities are taking place within the cytoplasm. It is a cytoplasm that keep the cell in the living state. Ribosomes are non-membrane bound organelles. So usually cell organelles are bound by a membrane bound organelle. So each organelle will be having membrane, either single membrane or double layered membrane. So they all will be bound by a membrane to keep it separate from other organelles. But ribosomes are non-membrane bound organelles, and these are scattered in the cytoplasm, chloroplast, and you can see them in mitochondria and even a rough endoplasmic reticulum. So chloroplast, or in plastids in general, and mitochondria, cytoplasm, attached to rough endoplasmic reticulum and all, you can see ribosomes. Ribosomes are the site of protein synthesis. So it is at this particular, or in this particular organelle, that the protein synthesis is taking place. Of a protein synthesis, the ribosomes are very, very important. They are the sites of protein synthesis. Once again, all cells contain cytoplasm. It's a semi-fluid matrix where the different cellular activities are taking place. And it keeps the cell in the living state. Now, ribosomes. Ribosomes are non-membrane bound organelles. So usually they will be having, or all the organelles will be bound by a membrane. But in ribosomes, membranes are absent. They don't have any membrane covering. You can see them in the cytoplasm, in plastids like chloroplast, mitochondria, and even in rough attached to rough endoplasmic reticulum. Also, you can see ribosomes. So it is the presence of ribosomes that differentiate smooth endoplasmic reticulum from rough endoplasmic reticulum. In smooth endoplasmic reticulum, no ribosomes are present. Whereas in rough endoplasmic reticulum, ribosomes are attached to it, giving it a rough appearance. The smallest cell, mycoplasma, is the smallest cell, 0.3 μm in length. The largest isolated single cell, the egg of an ostrich, longest cell, nerve cell. Size of the bacteria is between 3 to 5 μm. Human RBC is 7 μm in diameter. So the dimensions of a few cells are given. The smallest cell is mycoplasma. It's also a type of bacteria. You had already learned in biological classification about mycoplasma. It's 0.3 μm in length. Largest cell is the egg of an ostrich, longest cell is nerve cell, and the size of the bacteria ranges between 3 to 5 μm. Human red blood cells, so their size is 7 μm in diameter. Okay, largest, smallest, longest cells, and size of bacteria and human RBCs are given just to compare. When the smallest cell is 0.3, bacteria, I told you mycoplasma is also a type of bacteria, and the size of the bacteria is between 3 to 5 μm, not about mycoplasma. And human RBCs, the size is approximately 7 μm in diameter. Now, based on the functions.
Ma'am, can you show the previous slide?
Yes, I will show. The shape of the cells can be different, or cells come in different shapes. So it depends upon its function. For example, epithelial cells. Epithelial cells are for covering and protecting your body. So it should be flat. It should be flat. Only then they can form a covering to protect the different organs and the external surface of the body. So it will be flat. Whereas nerve cell has to transmit impulses, carry information from one part of the body to the other. So they are long. So the shape of the cell depends on the function it has to perform. So it can be columnar, cuboidal, thread-like, irregular, disc-like, or polygonal. And cells can be broadly classified into two types, prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Already when we discussed about this chapter, or when I gave you the introduction in the previous class, we had discussed about prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells. Okay. If you haven't completed this one, you can note it down. What are prokaryotic cells?
Cells
which are not having a well-defined nucleus, or where the nuclear membrane is absent and they just have the genetic material, or that nuclear region, we call it as nucleoid. So instead of nucleus, they have nucleoid, and here the nuclear membrane is absent, or else you can say they don't have a well-defined nucleus. Now we are going to learn about prokaryotic cells in detail. They don't have a nucleus. I told you already, they are having just a nucleoid, or nuclear membrane is absent. And apart from that, no membrane bound organelles are present. Neither membrane bound nucleus nor cell organelles. So they don't have any membrane bound organelles or nucleus. And they include different organisms like, so example for prokaryotic or, yes, Hasif? Hasif, any doubt?
No, no.
Mute your microphone. They include bacteria, blue-green algae, mycoplasma, and PPLO, pleuropneumonia-like organisms. So these are some examples for prokaryotic organisms or organisms consisting of prokaryotic cells. They are generally smaller. Just a minute. They are generally smaller and they multiply more rapidly than eukaryotic cells. So when compared to eukaryotic cells, they multiply rapidly. They are smaller in size too. Once again, so here membrane bound nucleus and organelles are absent, and examples include bacteria, blue green algae, otherwise known as cyanobacteria. And then mycoplasma, I told that is also a type of bacteria. PPLO, pleuropneumonia-like organisms. This pleuropneumonia-like organisms are also a type of mycoplasma. So all these are more or less related: bacteria, cyanobacteria or blue-green algae, then mycoplasma and PPLO, pleuropneumonia-like organism. That is also a type of, a specialized type of mycoplasma. They are generally smaller in size and they can multiply rapidly. When compared to eukaryotic cells, they are smaller. These cells are smaller and they multiply rapidly, and their shape and size can differ. So here you can see four shapes of bacteria. Bacteria, they come in four different shapes. You can see the pictures of the different types of bacteria over here. And Bacillus, Coccus, Vibrio and Spirillum. Bacillus, these are rod shaped. Coccus will be spherical. Vibrio, comma shaped. Spirillum, spiral shape. So they come in different shapes and sizes. The size also differs and the shape is also, shapes are also different. Once again, the members do not have any membrane bound nucleus or organelles. Examples include bacteria, blue green algae, mycoplasma, PPLO. And when compared to eukaryotic cells, they are smaller in size and they can multiply rapidly. They differ in their shape and size. And bacteria, they come in four different basic shapes. Spirillum, spiral shape. It is spiral. You can see in the figure, they appear to be spiral shaped structures. Hence the name spirillum. Vibrio, comma shaped. Coccus, spherical shape. And bacillus, rod shaped. Once again, so Bacillus bacteria, they are rod shaped, Coccus spherical, and Vibrio, they are comma shaped, whereas Spirillum, spiral shaped. So these are the different types of bacteria based on their shapes. Absence of organelles. So here already we mentioned this point in prokaryotic cells. Organelles are absent, membrane bound organelles are absent, but they contain ribosomes. Ribosomes are not having any membrane covering. They are not membrane bound. And ribosomes are found both in prokaryotes and eukaryotes. So it can be asked to name an organelle which is found in prokaryotic organisms. So generally they don't contain or they don't have any membrane bound organelles, but this membrane bound structure, that is ribosome, that is found even in prokaryotic cells. have specialized differentiated cell membranes called mesosomes. So in prokaryotic cells, apart from ribosomes, you can see some infoldings of the cell membrane. So the cell membrane will fold inwards. You will learn more about mesosomes later. So some infoldings of the plasma membrane, or the plasma membrane will fold inwards to form structures known as mesosomes. And they contain inclusion bodies too. So they contain some other structures known as inclusion bodies. So we'll be learning about each one after completing this. So you learn about mesosomes, inclusion bodies, ribosomes, etc. Once again, membrane bound cell organelles are absent in prokaryotic cells, but they do contain ribosomes. Ribosomes are not having any membrane covering. These are the sites of protein synthesis. And apart from that, certain other structures known as mesosomes are found. These are formed by the infoldings of plasma membrane. A plasma membrane folds inwards and forms structures known as mesosome. And along with that, certain inclusion bodies are also found within the cell. We'll start with nucleoid. Already we learned what is meant by a nucleoid. Here a well-defined nucleus is absent. The nuclear material is not bound by a nuclear membrane. And this undefined nuclear region, you call it as nucleoid. The undefined nuclear region found in prokaryotic cells is known as nucleoid. And they may have plasmids. Plasmids are small circular DNAs. So they have the chromosomal DNA. The genomic DNA is present over here. This is the genomic DNA. So apart from that, they have certain other structures or certain other circular DNAs. These are circular DNAs along with the genomic DNA. Those are known as plasmids. Plasmids are having so much of significance in genetic engineering or in biotechnology. So plasmids, they are used for transferring a genetic material, foreign genetic material, or a piece of DNA from one organism to a host cell. You know that human insulin, what is human insulin, children? What is the role of human insulin? Insulin, what is that? Nobody knows what is insulin? What is it actually? You want me to call out your name? Yes, Nimita?
To control sugar.
To control?
The sugar.
Sugar. To control the sugar level. What is that actually? It's a hormone produced by which endocrine gland? Is it because you're lazy to unmute or you don't know the answer? Which endocrine gland produces insulin?
Pancreas.
And you know that in diabetic patients, their insulin production is not sufficient and they will have to inject insulin. Earlier, we used to extract insulin from cattle, pigs, etc. But many of them developed allergic reactions. But now with biotechnology, we have succeeded in producing human insulin on a large scale or on a commercial scale using this plasmid. So what is done is this plasmid is used to transfer the human gene responsible for producing insulin. And this will be transferred into a host organism, usually a bacteria. And there this gene will multiply, resulting in the production of insulin, which you will learn in detail in class 12. So I just want to tell you the significance, to make you understand the significance of plasmid, these extra chromosomal DNAs. So apart from the genomic DNA or chromosomal DNA is there, apart from that, which is not bound by a nuclear membrane, that is present. Apart from that, some circular DNAs are also present. It can be more than one in number, and those are known as plasmids. We call them as vectors also. Vectors, you know, you have learned about insect vectors, which will transmit the disease from a healthy person, sorry, from a disease, from an affected person to a healthy person. Okay, so just like that, these plasmids also will help in transferring foreign DNA to the host DNA. That is done with a purpose. So they are having these plasmids present in eukaryotic cells, are having so much of significance in genetic engineering. The plasmid DNA provides or confers characteristics like antibiotic resistance to bacteria, and they also monitor bacterial transformation with foreign DNA. So they act as carriers. So they will transfer the foreign DNA into the host DNA. They will bring about the transformation of the bacteria with the help of or with foreign DNA, by transferring foreign DNA to a host organism, which is a bacteria. They can bring about bacterial transformation. So no need to worry much about this process. You'll be learning in detail in class 12. So once again, in prokaryotic cells, a well-defined nucleus is absent. The undefined nuclear region, you can call as nucleoid. Here the nuclear membrane is absent. And apart from that, they are not having any membrane-bound organelles too. But the one organelle which is present in them, that is ribosome, which is not bound by any membrane, these are the sites of protein synthesis. And the plasma membrane can fold inwards and can form certain structures known as mesosomes. Along with that, some inclusion bodies are also scattered in the cytoplasm. Then we learned about plasmid. Plasmids are circular DNAs along with the genomic DNA present in prokaryotic cells. And these plasmids will provide antibiotic resistance to antibiotics in bacteria, and they also bring about transformation of bacteria with foreign DNA. So details I told in class 12 you'll be learning. Now we will see what are mesosomes. Already I told you how are mesosomes formed. It is clear in this picture. So the plasma membrane is folding inwards and forming structures known as mesosomes. They are formed by the extensions of plasma membrane into the cell. These extensions are in the form of vesicles, tubules, or lamellae. Vesicles are bag-like structures, some sac-like structures, or in the form of tubules, small tubes, or like a flat plate-like structures known as lamellae. So these extensions, mesosomes, can be in different shapes, either in the form of vesicles, tubules, or lamellae. Once again, mesosomes are found in prokaryotic cells. These are the extensions of plasma membrane into the cell, or formed by the foldings of plasma membrane. So plasma membrane, they can fold inwards and they can form structures known as mesosomes. They can fold inwards and they can form mesosomes. And these extensions of the plasma membrane can be either in the form of bag-like structures known as vesicles, tubules, or lamellae. Now coming to the functions. What are the different functions performed by mesosomes? They help in cell wall formation. They help in the formation of cell wall. Then DNA replication. Replication. Replica means a copy. DNA will replicate. DNA will make a copy of itself. When a cell is dividing, you know that first the genetic material should divide, or the nucleus should divide, followed by the division of the cell or the cytoplasm. So the DNA has to replicate. It has to make a copy of itself. Only then the DNA can be equally distributed among the daughter cells. So the replication of, or the duplicating of DNA, is known as DNA replication. then and distributing it to the daughter cells, replication of DNA and distributing it to the daughter cells, then respiration, secretion, and it also helps in increasing the surface area. Children, you had learned about villi. Villi, these are finger-shaped projections. So presence of villi will help in increasing the surface area for absorption when they are present on the small intestine. So similarly, when these foldings are there in the plasma membrane, that will help in increasing the surface area of plasma membrane and also increase the enzymatic content because there is more surface area to hold it. Once again, the different functions performed by mesosome, it helps in the formation of cell wall, replication of DNA, once replicated, to distribute, it has to be distributed equally to the daughter cells, then respiration, secretion helps in increasing the surface area of the cell, surface area of the plasma membrane. Plasma membrane is a part of cell, so surface area as such of the cell also will be enhanced, and definitely the enzymatic content also will be increased. So these are the different functions performed by mesosome. Once again, helps in the formation of cell wall, replication of DNA and its distribution to the daughter cells, then secretion, respiration, increasing the surface area of plasma membrane and enzymatic content are the some of the functions performed by mesosomes. Is that okay, children? You want to repeat any of the slide or any of the point?
Ma'am.
Yes.
Will you repeat the last point of nucleoid?
Nucleoid.
Yes,
ma'am. Okay, wait a minute. The plasmid DNA. What are plasmids? Plasmids are circular DNAs. You can see in the figure. Circular DNA along with the chromosomal DNA. So the main genetic material is present over here. The main genetic material of the genomic DNA is there. Apart from that, there will be so many circular DNAs scattered in its cytoplasm. You call it as plasmid. And presence of plasmid can provide them resistance to antibiotics. Presence of plasmids can provide them antibiotic resistance to different antibiotics, and also it will help in monitoring the transformation of bacteria with foreign DNA. See, this plasmid can be used for transferring the genetic material. One minute. Okay, here, say for example, this is a plasmid. And suppose you want to, this is E. coli, one bacteria, okay? And then you want to make multiple copies of a particular gene. Then what is done? I told you the example of insulin. So what is done is, this is the gene for human insulin, the gene responsible for the production of human insulin. So from plasmid, from plasmid, a piece will be removed, and in place of that, this will be introduced. This will be introduced, and this will be transferred into the host cell, a host organism. So when this is dividing, when it is undergoing division, so this gene along with the other part of plasmid, along with the genetic material, this also gets keep on, it also will keep on increasing in number. And you know that they multiply very rapidly. This also keeps on getting multiplied and we get the desired product. So if I explain more, you will get confused. So just understand that plasmid DNA, these are extra chromosomal, other than the genomic DNA or chromosomal DNA, some circular DNAs are present in prokaryotic cells. and they are very useful in carrying out biotechnology, or to carry out different experiments in biotechnology, or to carry out genetic engineering. And these plasmids, they act as vectors for transferring a foreign DNA into a host organism. Suppose you want to make multiple copies of a desired gene, with the help of a plasmid, you can transfer it into a host organism where they will get multiplied. And here two functions of plasmids are also mentioned. One is it will provide resistance to antibiotics, to bacteria where it is present. When these are present, depending upon the composition, so these plasmids can provide resistance to antibiotics. Second one, it will bring about the transformation of bacteria. When a foreign DNA is introduced into that, so there will be a transformation. The genetic material will undergo transformation. Their properties will change, or the genetic characters can change. So these two points you learn. Plasmids provide antibiotic resistance and also monitor bacterial. Monitor means they just control or regulate or observe bacterial transformation with foreign DNA. You will be learning in detail. You have two biotechnology chapters and one lengthy chapter, molecular basis of inheritance. So there all your doubts will be cleared. It's a very vast topic. So for the time being, you just understand this. Okay, it will bring about bacterial transformation with foreign DNA and also provides antibiotic resistance in bacteria. Okay, Milin?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. We will continue next class. So thank you, children. See you next period.
Thank you.